Ευχαριστώ πολύ για την πρόσκληση. Είναι τιμή μου να βρίσκομαι μαζί σας και εκείνο που προσπαθήσω να κάνω, επειδή εγώ είμαι βασικός επιστήμον, δηλαδή προσπαθώ να βρω τους μηχανισμούς πώς ακριβώς δουλεύουν τα πράγματα που συζητάμε, θα ασχοληθώ με βασική έρευνα και θα προσπαθήσω να σας δώσω μια γεύση του τι ακριβώς είναι τα ερωτήματα που έχουμε και πώς αρχίζουμε να προσπαθούμε να τα απαντήσουμε. I'm going to continue, θα συνεχίσω στα αγγλικά γιατί στο επιστημονικό κομμάτι θα πηγαίνω εύκομαι, επομένως για τους μεταφραστικούς λόγους, καλύτερα να μείνω με τα αγγλικά. So, thank you very much for the invitation and I am very happy to give you a basic science perspective of what, how we approach questions that we don't know the answers to. And so, I chose to speak about bitter taste. I love the example of the olive from Olympia because that olive oil came with extremely high phenolic content, but the olive oil producers came to Professor Mariatis and Dr. Menu and posed the question, it's too bitter. It really cannot be ingested. It's wonderful in terms of what you're telling us the phenolic content is, but how can we help it? And the question is, if we have such a product that has extremely high bitter taste, what is it that we can do about it? We don't know the answer. So I'm going to give you a flavor of how one would go about it. So this work has now been done. I just recently moved to Boston, Northeastern University. You see here a wonderful building that brings scientists and engineers together with the goal of interdisciplinary science. And I'm going to try to give you a flavor of how scientists are thinking of bitter taste and what is it that we can do to understand how the phenolic content, let's say, of olive oil, how oleocanthal or leucine or whatever the phenol of interest may be, how does it work? So, in this diagram, which is hard to see, I'll try to walk you through the physiology. What is it that we are studying? You have a taste gland, which is right here, and the taste gland is seeing a protein, a molecule that is embedded in the membrane of cells, in the what we call the plasma membrane. This is a receptor, and this receptor is going to basically bind to the taste gland, in this case, let's say, a bitter taste compound, and will signal inside the cell so the cell knows how to interpret this signal, the bitter tasting compound. And so how does it do that? It signals to different proteins that are associated or are part of the membrane, proteins again, through what we call the G proteins. These G proteins basically take the signal from the receptor and transduce it, transfer it to whatever enzyme or molecule they want to affect. So a bitter tasting compound will activate the G proteins. The G proteins will signal to the protein that will now trigger changes inside the cell that need to be interpreted. And in this case, what the G proteins do is to signal an enzyme to break down a lipid, a fat, in the membrane, in its components, a soluble part, which is called IP3, inositol-3-phosphate, and a membrane-bound part, which is called diacylglycerol. So this soluble component, what does it do? It goes and binds to another receptor in an organelle inside the cell called the endoplasmic reticulum that contains calcium. This calcium storage organelle now is going to release the calcium inside the cell. So the taste gland, the bitter taste compound, results in having increased calcium inside the cell. And that's the signal. That is what the cell interprets as what has happened. And what does that do? It affects another protein that is in the membrane that allows ions to go through it. It's called the TRPM channel. It's an ion channel that allows sodium to get into the cell And that results in ATP from the inside of cell being actually secreted to the outside. Neurons receive that ATP signal and signal to the brain. And that's how we go from our tongue through this calcium mechanism to signal to our brain of what we have tasted. Okay, so what does all that have to do with how we taste different bitter compounds? How is that enabled? There are 25 receptors that can bind different taste buds. There are 25 genes that make proteins, 25 proteins that we know of. A leading lab in Germany, Professor Meyerhoff's lab, has shown that in fact these receptors can combine and form combinations of different receptors. And there, he calculated and showed that 268 different combinations of receptors can be formed from the 25 that we know. So now imagine how many possibilities we have for actually binding one signal to one receptor or to a combination of receptors and interpreting it. It's limitless, okay? We have so many taste buds that we can taste, produce that calcium, and get our brain to understand some different modality of taste. So with that, I want to take you to how are we studying this, just to give you a flavor that this is the problem. We have these receptors, the taste buds will come, we'll bind them, and what happens? How do we know what happens? And so the assays are twofold. One is calcium. We want to be able to monitor calcium. So we have a so-called calcium assay, calcium mobilization assay, and I'll show you in a minute how we do this. But basically, we can do using this calcium mobilization assay, where we measure calcium directly, we can basically tell, we can have a high throughput screening. We can take many compounds and see, you know, how which of these compounds signal through a particular receptor. Thousands of compounds and find out whether they signal through one of the 25 receptors or through one of the combinations. It is a high throughput assay, but there are, in order for us to get these measurements, we have to do a lot of tweaking, and it's not exactly the natural way of measurement. So there's always a question, is our engineering that we have done in order to measure altering what is actually naturally happening? So we have a second assay that is more natural, okay, we're measuring, let's say, the ion channel activity, these ions that are coming into the cell, and that is more natural, but on the other hand, this doesn't have the benefit of being able to do many compounds at once. We have to do one cell at a time, and so it's not high throughput. So here you can see, for example, that we use a reporter, an ion channel compound, a taste that comes. We can activate this compound. It's a very high fidelity assay, but it's only one at a time. And finally, there is a third test that we do, and that is we monitor if the receptor is expressed, it's actually reaching the cell surface. And we can do this with antibodies and with fluorescence microscopy. So let me just show you a couple of the records. So here is a calcium signal, and this is a machine that we use, a small academic version. There are much larger ones that you can do hundreds and thousands of tests simultaneously. And when we put the taste that is shown here with this arrow, we get a beautiful calcium signal, a transient calcium signal. So we know that the taste stem has elicited this calcium response. And what we can do is we can vary the concentration of the taste stem and look at the response, this fluorescence response, and we can get what is called a concentration response curve. And then that is very characteristic of that compound. It tells us that, let's say, at this concentration, we get the half maximal response. And that is sort of a way of characterizing the receptor. pharmacology of the receptor. It also allows us to activate the receptor with a ligand like this PTWR, this taste receptor, and then inhibit it with an inhibitor. And you can see here that we can inhibit the activity once the receptor has been activated. So we can do these pharmacological tests with the fluorescence assay, the calcium fluorescence assay, or we can do it with this ion channel assay. And we have a model system. These are oocytes from a Xenopus gibbis South African frog. We inject the messenger RNA in there, and then a couple of days later, we can stick electrodes into the cell and record these currents, the ions that flow through the proteins that we've introduced, and tell us how the taste and the binds to the receptor activates the ion channel. And now if we compare the slow assay, the one from ion channels, with the one with the fluorescence for a molecule, strychnine, which is a poison pretty much, and it tastes very bitter, and in fact the bitter taste evolved that way, right? It's a way for us to know what to avoid, but we now know better. We know that in things that taste bitter sometimes we have fantastic nutritional value and fantastic agents that do a lot of good. So it's not a simplistic avoid it, it's not always right. So here with strychnine, you can see we can do the pharmacological comparison and get comparable values, but we can limitations of one technique can be overcome with the other. Here you can see also that we can localize where the receptors go. And for example, this taste receptor number 8 is going to the cell surface, as we can see here, so we know that it's expressed. There are 4 of these 25 receptors that we don't know what the tastants, tastants are. There haven't been any that have been described for this receptor. But we can see them going to the cell surface. It's just a matter of time before we figure out what compounds trigger them. And here is another example of such a receptor. So here is the test that I wanted to get you to appreciate. Okay, so here we have all 25 receptors, including the 4 that are orphan, that we don't have yet any ligands. And we have taken one compound that is bitter, and run them through these 25 receptors. And lo and behold, there is only one receptor, 46, that responds to this tastant. So taste receptor, bitter taste receptor 46, is the only one that responds to this tastant. Now this picture is not that simple. Many times, a bitter compound will trigger the activity of not just one receptor, but several receptors, 2, 3, 4, okay? And what our task is to try to figure out what a particular tastant or leucanthal, let's say, what receptors does it trigger and what sensation, taste, quality does that translate to? So here is our program that we're seeking funding from NIH to develop taste receptor inhibitors. For example, there are HIV drugs for children that are bitter, and they are delivered orally, and they are in liquid form, and so the children will not take them. And so finding what receptors they act through and inhibiting the taste receptors that give the bitter taste and prevent the children from taking them is a way of going about it. So where we want to take this work is exactly in the field of olive oil. We want to know what phenolic compounds have what bitter taste sensations, and understand these bitter taste sensations by exactly knowing what receptors are being activated. So I'll be happy to answer any questions. I know this is a technical, basic science talk, but I wanted to give you the flavor of what are the questions and how we're going about it. Thank you.